Let's bring in our friend, our guest, Sean Spicer, whose new book, Leading America, President Trump's Commitment to People, Patriotism, and Capitalism, is available now. Very nice book cover, by the way.
Thank you.
Sean, it's good to see you. I've got to get your reaction to that clip, because that I've never seen anything like that before. Your thoughts?
The best part about it is her accusing Wolf Blitzer of being an apologist for the Trump team. And I'm thinking to myself, all this time I was at the RNC in the White House and I never knew Wolf Blitzer was on my team.
You would have taken advantage of that had you known.
I know.
That was amazing.
Don't tell me. Is Acosta with us too?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Right. Can you imagine finding that, something like that out? I was watching this back and forth. She was mad, but I mean, clearly mad. And Wolf Blitzer, to his credit, he wasn't going to let her walk on this. Are we at a turning point, especially after the administration has tried to do so much as it relates to relief for Americans because of this economic lockdown that Democrats insisted would still be going on if they had their way? And Democrats refused to come to the table. They refused to vote on any of these relief packages that the president has pushed. Are we at a turning point now where they're even starting to lose Democrats?
Yeah, I mean, look, first of all, Wolf Blitzer was asking her about a concern that Ro Khanna, one of her own members had. One of her own members tweeted. That was the concern. It wasn't like Donald Trump had made a comment. Wolf was asking her about something that one of her own Democratic congressmen from California had brought up on Twitter and asked her to get back to the table. The idea, by the way, that we are talking about the fact that $1.8 trillion with a T is not enough is a problem. The idea that that's happening is a problem. I think the other thing that happened there was Pelosi looked and said, how come Biden doesn't have to answer questions and I do? Don't you just get to say, I'm not going to discuss it because it will be a headline and then you all move on? And she's thinking to herself, how come I get the tough questions and Biden doesn't have to answer anything?
Yeah, well, because he calls lids at 8 a.m. I mean, he called a lid already today the moment that New York Post story came out about Hunter Biden and all of these photos, literally, of him with crack pipes, like photos of him with crack pipes in his mouth. Like this, I mean, it's like one of our producers, Steve, said it was like a game of Clue. It's Hunter Biden in the bedroom with a crack pipe. The moment this happens, I mean, Joe Biden calls a lid. So I guess he doesn't want to take any questions. Do you think, Sean, that this, because they're having dueling town halls, the president's going to be on with NBC tomorrow, Joe Biden's expected to be on with ABC tomorrow. Do you think that that's going to be brought up in Biden's town hall at all?
No, because it's not like one of the undecided voters. Undecided voters in a Biden town hall are like the kind of people who don't know whether they want a Diet Coke or a water. They're not undecided about who they're voting for. This is how ABC likes to present them. And Trump, it's like, these are never Trumpers.
Yeah.
When Biden has one, they call them undecided voters. It's like, here's Joe's cousin, Susie. She has a question. I mean, like, it's the contrast is just incredible. And yet, no one seems to bat an eye. You were talking about it a moment ago, and I think you're absolutely right. But it's beyond that. They are so invested in a Biden administration and seeing the end of Donald Trump that they don't have – there's no apology anymore. They don't try to hide it. They don't try to fake it. They literally are like, you know, I'm sorry, Mr. Biden, for asking that tough question. I'll get back to my ones on Donald Trump now.
Yeah.
And I think that's it is. In my mind, I don't know how you are an older reporter, right? So like I'm talking like the Wolf Blitzers of the world, and look at how some of these junior reporters act and aren't embarrassed for your profession.
No, that's a great point. And you being previously White House press secretary, you had experience with this and you saw it. You were in front of these folks day in and day out. And there's definitely, I think there is a marked difference between those who are older, with, you know, the exception of Jim Acosta. But those who are a little bit older and they're used to the formality of how things are conducted. And those who are younger, who seem hungrier for just basically getting that soundbite and kind of, you know, you make a spectacle of yourself and that's the story for like one news cycle. And then the next day it's something new. And there's really not anything that is of insight that is presented or distributed to the voters that are depending upon that profession for information. And that's the thing with it. I want to get to your book as well, Leading America, President Trump's Commitment to People, Patriotism, and Capitalism. I want to ask you about this, but I want to get your reaction to one more thing, because I really like this. This was the president's rally, audio soundbite 31, yesterday, and I've been looking at the polling. I remember, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, because you were there at the time, I remember in 2016, in all of the battleground states, I think it was showing that Hillary Clinton was, I think, within 6 points of Donald Trump during election night, and then he runs away with it in all these different states that were historically Democrat previously. And with Joe Biden, it's even closer, and apparently it's even closer than we all originally thought. Surprise, surprise. But there was one demographic that is constantly thrown in the administration's face, and that is with suburban women. And I loved this soundbite from the president last night.
Oh, I know where you're going.
It is hysterical. Let's play this for everybody.
I ask you to do me a favor. Suburban women, will you please like me?
Remember?
Please. I saved your damn neighborhood, okay? The other thing, I don't have that much time to be that nice. You know, I can do it, but I got to go quickly.
I don't know how somebody listens to that and then walks away with thinking, no, I still don't like him. I mean, it's funny. And whenever he goes into that self-deprecating mode, he just endears himself to voters.
That's the Trump I love, right? And I was listening to that last night. I just started laughing because the mannerisms at the same time were so spectacular. And the idea that he said, please just like me. I mean, you can tell that it's almost like he was on the plane and they're like, okay, Mr. President, here are the latest poll numbers. You're doing well in Ohio. In Florida, you're doing okay with seniors. But suburban women continue to plague us in Pennsylvania. And like, he was just like, all right, that's it. I'm going to ask him to like me.
Yeah, I'm going to ask him to like me. And I think, you know, I mean, it was interesting, the reaction to it, because, you know, there were people who were like, okay, that was actually funny what he said last night. And it is, I mean, I think it just, he's a very different kind of politician. And I know you touch on that in your book, which is what I wanted, it's why you're here. And congrats on the book, by the way. Tell me about this. I mean, obviously you have there are a lot of books written by people about the administration, but there's only one of them that have been written by someone who worked with him as closely as you did day in and day out, not just during, you know, the campaign, but even after the transition and then later on with the press. Talk to me a little bit about the just how you have seen the biggest thing to me is seeing how the administration interacts, not just with its base, but with the American people. This has been a very different Republican administration, I think, for the better. Talk to me a little bit about that. And what does this mean for the next 4 years, too, of the Republican Party after the president wins in November?
Well, I think it's been disruptive overall. And I think what Trump brought to the office that was so different is, whether it was the pundit class, the press, the lobbyists, they were used to all being sucked up to for different reasons, right? You wanted a good story, you needed their money, whatever it was. And Trump sort of came into Washington with this philosophy that, look, I'm going to do all this stuff. If you want to come along for the ride, you're welcome to it, but you're not getting sucked up to. And a lot of their egos were shattered. And I think that he has slowly started to rebuild things in a way that people are getting the game. But you look at the different facets, whether it's corporate America, the defense industrial complex, that folks have started to realize that business as usual is over. And I think that's what's so interesting about Trump, is the way he operates isn't through a series of PowerPoint presentations that gets circulated through multiple, you know, decision-making circles and up the chain. If he knows it's a good idea, if it's going to make the country better, if it's going to bring in more money to people's pockets or help businesses thrive, he's just like, all right, get it done. He knows time is short. And when you go down the list of accomplishments, from the trade deals to what he did for the military, to his foreign policy accomplishments, to cutting taxes and regulations, he gets it, which is, I'm not just looking to get one deal. He said this in the rally the other night where he said, you know, think about it, Space Force. He's like, how many people? That would be their big achievement. He's like, that was one of ours. And he's right. I think that he is constantly striving to say, okay, got that done. Now let's go. Let's keep going. There's no rest with him. He understands the time is short.
Yeah, he does. And I think that you make a very good point too. People are so used to being sucked up to. And also, he brings in people who, okay, I want you for this job right now because this is what I need done right now. And then maybe, you know, in a couple of months, it's changed. Our perspective has changed. And he rotates out and still keeps on very good terms with everyone. But I like the delegation, because that's sort of, you know, it's behavior indicative of somebody who's used to leading and used to getting things done. But Washington isn't used to seeing things run that
right
way. Your thought?
Yeah. And I think, you know, part of the book is to walk through all the different aspects of our society. So it's mm-hmm. big tech, corporate America, Hollywood, and talk about how these policies and the right is being affected by them. And I think people, yes. if you're someone on the right and you want to get a real good grasp on what's going on in our society today, when you read the book, I think you're going to have this aha moment that I didn't realize that that was why reporters act the way they do. I didn't realize that corporate America acts in a certain way because of the following. And it was, to me, I learned a lot in researching this book, because I think that there is such an offense at the Trump policy that is not just this center right or center left. It's looking to wholesale change it, to bring about fundamental change in so many areas. And that's what threatens the livelihood of so many folks in America right now that are used to going along to get along. As long as I, you know, pony up, I pay up, I behave correctly, I'm going to get taken care of. And that's no longer the case.
Yeah. One of the, in chapter 8 of your book, you have great, I love the title of this, grade schools as battlegrounds, ABCs and Zer and Z's, and getting into the pronoun, well, yeah, the pronouns with the woke scolds. But this was something that too, that came up, and it was discussed again today during the Supreme Court hearings, because this administration has really pushed school choice unlike any other administration that I've ever seen, right. And has accurately called it the civil rights issue of our time. And I thought it was very interesting how it came, how the way that Democrats wanted to approach it and the way that Republicans approach it by way of the administration was really contrasted with these Supreme Court hearings, because Democrats want to use the courts to ban this and not leave it up to the voters. Whereas Republicans in the Trump administration, they don't want to use the courts to mandate something like this, but they want this process to play out with the voters, give people their rights as citizens to voice their affirmation or rejection of school choice. That's what the administration's always been about, which is such a huge threat to, you know, as you discuss in this, really it's cultural warfare. It's thought control. And I love this chapter as well, because this is something we're actually dealing with in our neighborhood right now, but nationally as well.
Well, look, I mean, there's a couple things there. One is, I think these hearings have really shown the contrast between how Republicans and Democrats look at the courts, mm-hmm. right? Republicans keep talking about the Constitution and the laws. Democrats keep talking about, how do you feel? What do you want to have happen? And it's like, she keeps saying over and over again, well, what does the law say? What does precedent say? And they're like, yeah, but what do you feel? What do you feel yeah. about that? And it's like, she keeps saying, that's not the point. It shouldn't be about what I feel. It should be about what the law is. But with respect to education specifically, you know, these schools, especially the K-12, have gotten away from teaching kids about reading and writing and science and history, and started talking about taking up causes. I mean, taking up, this is what you should protest. This is the kind of material that you should write. This is the way you should feel, this whole woke culture, the cancel culture. But one chapter in there, Dana, talks about the fact that, like, there are schools across the country, including one here near me in Fairfax County, Virginia, that gives kids the day off to go protest climate change.
Yeah.
Now, there's a lot of people on the left that would say, well, that's a good thing. Why not? And I would argue two things. Number one, they should be learning. This is when you get into school. We're falling behind China and areas like STEM. And the last thing we need is another day off to go out and hold a sign up. It may be a big enough issue, but that's not for the school to decide. It's up to parents to decide what issues and values they want to instill in their children. And here's the thing. If that's the cause, and you say, well, Sean, I care about global warming. And I say this, I go, okay, tell me what happens if Republicans take over your school board and they want your kids to attend a March for Life. Are you okay then? Because liberals are okay as long as the issue is what they want protested. But as soon as it's not, I guarantee you they're going to have a very different tune about how all this plays out. And that's where I think the real interest is here, is that they don't realize what's happening in a lot of these schools and what teachers are doing beyond teaching anymore.
Yeah, that's a great point. The book, Leading America, President Trump's Commitment to People, Patriotism, and Capitalism, by our friend Sean Spicer. You can find him on Newsmax as well, and Sean Spicer on Twitter. Sean, always so good to see you. Congrats on the book, and I know we'll be talking with you again. Thank you, my friend. Good to see you.
I hope so. Thank you.